I would like to cordially welcome you to our first virtual Asanokai. We have actually been pushing the idea of digital events for quite some time, but now the time for online meetings really seems to have come. And it's very nice to see many of you online today, zooming in from different parts of the world.
We have invited Edgar Walk to share his expertise with us. As chief economist in the asset management division of Metzler Bank, he is responsible for formulating global prospects on a very daily basis.
I have three general topics: Corona epidemic, globalization, supply chains, debt and central bank policy. I would like to start with the epidemic. Here you can see the number of daily new infections in Germany and in Japan. I think in Germany we already see that we have reached the tops at the moment are declining. In Japan we are probably at the moment forming a top, and I also reasonably optimistic that we could see a decline in the next few weeks, so that probably the worst is already behind us in the pandemic. And now the question is about opening up the economy, about a return to more normal economic levels. And I think this question is extremely difficult to answer. My understanding is that it's possible, and I will show you later why I think it's possible, especially when I look at China, Taiwan, and South Korea. I think these countries are ahead of Japan and Germany. And they, especially China, has already returned back to normal. This morning we got the latest car sales number in China, and they are back to the same level as in 2019 already. So a very quick and very sharp recovery in China. And I think something similar can be possible in Germany and in Japan as well. But I have to admit there's a lot of uncertainty. And that's something which we have to follow basically every day. What are the implications from what we have seen already? I think here you can see that inflation expectation in financial markets for the next 10 years. So before the crisis, in January, the expectation was that we will have around 1.2% inflation in the euro area in the next 10 years, in the US 2%. And now in the euro area, we are at 0.6, and in the US, 1.2%. So the idea is, or the interpretation is, that basically the corona epidemic is a huge deflationary shock for the world economy, and inflation expectations have fallen sharply. And I think this is extremely important later when we talk about supply chains. The next conclusion is that we have seen governments and central banks reacting. And here you see the fiscal stimulus in percent of global GDP. And in the financial crisis 2008-2009, we already had huge support from governments to save the banking system, to save more or less the global economy, but it was only 1.5% of global GDP. Now we are already at 3%, so almost double. And if I include the latest news from Germany, from the US, I think we could even go to 3.5% or 4% stimulus. So it's more than double what we have seen in 2008-2009. And with this huge fiscal stimulus, there's a discussion about, is the debt explosion sustainable? Will we get a debt crisis? And that I will address in the last chapter. But I think one important conclusion is that we have already laid the basis for a very strong economic upswing because governments are spending so much money. And that's why I'm reasonably optimistic that we will see an economic upswing in the second half of 2020. With the support mainly of governments. So my conclusions would be, as I mentioned, China, Taiwan, South Korea, they're already in a situation where there are hardly any new daily infections, where economic data has recovered sharply. So I would say it's a very low cost crisis in these countries. Government spending didn't increase sharply, but it's a very high cost crisis in Europe, Japan, United States. As I have shown you, budget deficits will explode, government debt will explode. I think that's one of the points I also would like to allude to later. I think we are past the worst, so we are now in a situation where the economy will improve, and it will improve with every easing of the measures we will get. My feeling is that the quarantine measures will be eased slowly at the beginning, but the easing will happen faster later on, probably in the second half of this year. And my scenario, which I have in mind, is that we are in Europe and United States will be able to follow China, South Korea and Taiwan to keep infection rates low and at the same time normalize economic activity. That's my base case scenario. I admit it's optimistic. There are a lot of different scenarios, but I think we will be able to follow these countries. So about globalization, as I mentioned, it's a very low-cost crisis in China, a high-cost crisis in the United States and in Europe. So the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, expects China to grow by 1.2% this year. And the IMF expects the U.S. economy to contract by around 6% this year. So the gap between China and U.S. is narrowing, and China is continuing to catch up. What you can see here is GDP in U.S. dollar based on market exchange rate. So that's relevant for companies. Often you see the Chinese economy is already bigger than the U.S. economy, but then usually the GDP in China is computed or by purchasing power parity exchange rates, and then you get a higher dollar number for China. But using market exchange rate, Chinese economy is still smaller than US, but it's really rapidly catching up, and especially this year. And what I found very interesting in this respect is I have taken this chart from the biggest hedge fund in the world. It's called Bridgewater. Ray Dalio, he's head of this hedge fund. He's making really good analysis, and I follow him very closely. And he showed how superpowers rose and declined over the centuries. So he uses quantitative measures for every country, and I think it's a very nice research. And clearly, in the past 100 years, it was the period of the United States, but we have seen in the last 2-3 decades, China has been catching up rapidly. And I think after coronavirus, after the crisis, China and United States will probably be on equal level. And so we can say, I think one of the key insights or key messages from the corona crisis is that economic power is shifting to Asia, and China is continuing to catching up with the United States. And now we have probably 2 superpowers on the same level in the world. And it's not only economically is China a superpower, but also looking at financial markets. So you have to have a safe asset as a superpower to be relevant. And up to now, the most safest asset was US Treasuries. But now the Chinese bond market was also extremely stable in the crisis. It's even up in US dollar year to date compared to emerging markets, which have declined very sharply. So this would be another indicator that China has become really a superpower, not only economically, but also financially on a level with the United States. It's really very important and not to be underestimated you should also keep in mind that the Chinese bond market is the second biggest in the world, around 14 trillion US dollar big, and I think the US bond market is 20 trillion. It shows also the importance. And now I think we come to a very important point. I have taken this from Bloomberg. It was a very nice story about something we have seen already in the past, or way back in the past, the conflict between power politics and the conflict between rule-based politics. And here the example, you can read it, I think, by yourself, shows that pure power politics is probably back now. And I'm thinking about Donald Trump. I think his intention is to destroy the rule-based system, so to destroy the World Trade Organization, to destroy World Health Organization, to destroy the rules, because clearly the US is still very powerful, and he wants, Donald Trump basically wants to make pure power politics. And I think it's a very good example that we have seen this in history before. And so on the next page, this also from this Bloomberg article, so Trump would be in the first paragraph, might makes right. That's probably his idea. And the idea of Europe, of Japan, and I think also of the US before Trump was that rule-based system, an international order, international law, where everybody can participate, is the better solution, makes for a more peaceful world, and is everybody benefits from this. But we are in this conflict now, and my understanding, my feeling is that we still really don't know where China is in this situation. So I would say under Trump, US will try to destroy the rule-based system. They want even to destroy the European Union. So it's more easy for them or for Trump to make pure power politics. But for China, it's still for me difficult to say which direction they are going. I think probably China is still open. So one scenario could be that they try to create their own area of influence in Asia, and that we can get two different economic areas, so one of the West, Europe and United States, with their own technology, and China and Asia as a region with their own technology. But it could also be that China is also in favor of a global rule-based system. For me, it's still very, very difficult to say. So my feeling is that the relationship between Europe and Japan, and also I would include Canada, is becoming much, much more important, because we are, if we work closely together, we would be a very powerful economic area, and we could to some extent counteract Donald Trump better, and could probably work better to keep a rule-based system in the global economy. We could also maybe persuade China also to work together and to keep the rule-based system in the world. But clearly it's a very difficult situation, and it's also difficult with three countries to have a united, to be united, it's clear. But I think it's a very, very important way forward, and I think that's why it's so important to have this close friendship and relationship between Germany and Japan and Europe and Japan. It's becoming even more important in this situation we are in. The best case scenario is that Trump loses the election, that Biden wins, that he returns to the old days of rule-based global trade, that also China moves in this direction, and then this threat would have been addressed. But we have to think about the worst case scenario and prepared for the worst case scenario, that Trump wins the election, that there are still high unemployment in the US next year, and Trump will then probably start the trade wars again, because he needs to create jobs in the US. And then it would be very important to have this united relationship between Europe, Japan, and probably Canada, to be a heavyweight. And you can see here, this is the GDP data for US. It's 21.4 trillion US dollar. In China, 14.1 trillion, and the three countries, European Union, Canada, and Japan, would be 25.2 trillion US dollar. So we would be powerful and probably could have an influence on world trade and the global economy. About supply chains, one word. So it's my feeling is it's extremely difficult to say at the moment what will happen to supply chains. I'm really closely following the media here in Germany. I'm also talking with our equity portfolio managers. They have a lot of contacts with companies, but probably it's still too early to get any information about how companies are likely to react. My feeling is, as I showed you earlier, inflation expectations have declined sharply, which means companies don't have any pricing power. It means also that China has been a reliable partner. So Chinese exports have recovered first. And I didn't read anything in any German newspaper about German company complaining about disruption of supply chains from China. I think yesterday the German car company Daimler said they already have their factories in China are already working for 2 weeks. They have no problem with supply chains, and now they're starting in Germany their factories again, and they also expect that supply chains will work smoothly. So I think for a company now in this situation to change their supply chain would be very expensive, and they wouldn't get any higher prices for their products. And all the companies are at the moment trying to secure cash flow. So my feeling is probably we don't see much of a change in supply chains, only if the government uses money. So if the German government says we need production of medical goods in Germany and we are ready to spend, I don't know, 1 billion euro, then I would expect a change in supply chains. But without government help, I don't expect any change. That would be my expectation at the moment. But clearly, maybe I'm wrong. I'm really in close contact with our portfolio managers, and maybe I have to change my view. But at the moment, I wouldn't expect much change. And clearly, Asia is becoming more important. China is becoming much more important. As a result of the crisis, maybe we are able to form a trading bloc, Japan, European Union, and Canada, I think, which would be very important and would be very positive for all of us. Coming to debt, as I mentioned, biggest fiscal stimulus probably since the Second World War. Debt levels will go up. And there's a lot of fears, especially in Germany, about the debt crisis. And so I think it makes a lot of sense to look at history. And here we have data for the UK until 1694. And you see that even the UK was able to live for several decades with a government debt to GDP ratio of above 200 after the wars against Napoleon. So it's not unusual for governments with a good standing in financial markets to have over a long period of time very high debt levels. And in UK, it took around 100 years until before the First World War to reduce debt back to normal levels. So it can take a very long time to reduce debt, but it's possible. And so my feeling is we really don't need to worry about debt too much, government debt too much. We think in the history it was possible to have high debt levels, and it was also possible to reduce debt. Maybe one more point about this, what I found very interesting. In the period from 1830-40 until 1910, the reduction in the debt to GDP ratio was mainly achieved through high budget surpluses. So investors in government bonds got relatively high real returns, but taxpayer had to pay high taxes and there was not much government spending in the economy. The debt reduction after the Second World War happened mainly through high inflation and low interest rates. So very different approach. Investors or savers paid for the reduction in debt, not the taxpayer and the population as before. And some economists say that because we have now general right to election, so everybody can vote, and voters don't like austerity. That's why it's for politicians very difficult to keep budget surpluses for a very long time. And so it's much easier to reduce debt by keeping interest rate at artificially low levels and inflation at a little bit above level to reduce debt, which is basically nothing else than a tax on savings. Yeah, it's an implicit tax on savings, and I would expect something similar going forward. So a lot of support from central banks. It's clear that interest rates will probably not go up in the next 10, 20, or 30 years. Interest rates have to remain low at current levels so that government financing is affordable and the debt to GDP ratios then can decline. And I think that's one of the conclusions of the crisis. And then the question is, if central banks are keeping interest rates at artificially low levels, if they buy government debt, if they basically conduct government financing, isn't there a risk of high inflation in the future? We have seen this in the past often, when central banks finance government spending, that there was inflation or even hyperinflation. Don't we need to worry about this maybe in 3 or 5 years' time? And here I think there's a very interesting research, a book published maybe 1 or 2 months ago from Professor Weizsäcker. And he says, probably we cannot compare the past with today, because today we have in Japan, in Europe, in the United States, aging societies. And life expectancy is increasing. So people are saving more for their retirement, much more. So every year people are saving more for retirement, but the corporate sector is not investing more. So we have a savings overhang, and the government needs to borrow money to take up the savings, otherwise we would get high unemployment. And that's why I think what we are seeing already in Japan for the last 20, 30 years, very high government debt levels, very low interest rates, no inflation, is a result of the aging of the societies, is a result that the private sector is saving a lot and governments are not actively trying to increase debt, but passively. They have to take up the savings of the private sector to avoid high unemployment. And that's why I'm also relatively relaxed about high government debt levels and support from the central banks. I'm really not worried about, I don't think it's a big risk going forward, given this environment. And I think the research from Professor Weizsäcker is up to the point. And here an example from Japan. You see, this is how much the Japanese government pays on its debt, less how much it takes in interest from its financial holdings. And in last year, the debt burden was zero. So even so, government debt to GDP ratio is 240% of GDP in Japan. Because interest rates are so low, the government has no interest rate burden net. And so it's no problem. The debt can really... It doesn't matter if debt to GDP ratio is 50, 240 or 500% if interest rates are at 0% and if the central bank buys government bonds. And as long as there's no inflation, there's no problem. And as I just mentioned, I think that because of the aging of the society, there will be no inflation. So here's the conclusion. Maybe one word about the US. If there would be turbulences in the bond market, if bond yields would go up, I think the US Central Bank, the Federal Reserve, would decide to make yield curve control. So they would fix the 10-year Treasury yield at something between 0.5 and 0.75%. For the euro area, it's much more difficult because that's a very fun paradox, basically. So in the US, the central bank can buy enough government bonds to keep interest rates lower, but the ECB cannot buy government bonds of Italy, for example, or Spain in unlimited size because of the legal frame. And that could be one of the big risks for a breakup of the euro area, because we are seeing at the moment that bond yields in Italy have moved up. I think we are already above 2%, and the ECB cannot buy more Italian government bonds to keep interest rates lower. So we have a very difficult situation in the eurozone, and governments have to find a solution to finance Italy, to finance Spain, so that there will be no debt crisis in the eurozone. So I'm not worried about the debt crisis in Japan, in UK or in US, because central banks can support the government. But I'm worried about the eurozone because the ECB cannot buy enough government bond as is needed to keep interest rates low at the moment. And we are seeing also that the sentiment in Italy has really deteriorated very sharply. So if I look at the polls, currently the two right-wing parties, Lega, has 30%, the Brothers of Italy have 13%, and they are both against the euro and against the European Union. And so we have to some extent a risk that in the next election we could get a very right-wing government in Italy, and we could get a discussion about exiting the European Monetary Union and the European Union, and this would be very damaging. It's very clear it would be economic suicide for Italy to leave, but as we see with Trump and other populists, economic arguments are not always the basis for decision for this kind of populists. So for the eurozone, there are still some uncertainty. It's a big shock, and we will see if it's possible to find a political solution, and also to be able to change the sentiment in Italy. Outside of Italy, what we can see is the sentiment in all European countries are very stable. Actually, the mainstream parties are winning. So it's really an Italian problem, in my feeling, not a European problem. That would be my key points. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Edgar, for this very intense facts and figures. And of course, for your economic outlook, not only in Europe, but also in the US and in Asia and Japan and China. I would like to open the floor for questions, maybe already posing one, if I may. And I think this includes the question of Ms. Ando already. You said that there's going to be a balance between the US, between Europe and between China, economically speaking. Where do you see Japan in this picture?
Clearly, I mean, for Japan, the US is extremely important, not only economically, but also militarily. So the US, the military cooperation between Japan and the US is very important. It's probably more important than the economic relationship with Europe. But still, my feeling is, when we discuss about a Trump-led United States, which wants to destroy the rule-based trade, global trade system, I think it's very important that someone stands up against the United States. And if Japan by itself would do it, it wouldn't matter And if the European Union would do it by itself, it would also not matter. It only matters if we basically cooperate together. And I think also Canada would fit very nicely in this picture. Only economically, clearly militarily, the US is extremely important for Japan and also for Europe. But still, I think it's only an idea or a forecast. Maybe it's not a fact yet. We have seen the economic partnership agreement between Japan and the European Union, I think, which is very important in this respect. But probably we would need more cooperation on an economic level between our areas. And basically, the idea is to stand up against the United States, which wants to destroy the rule-based global trade system. Yeah, that would be the idea. But the US has a lot of leverage against Europe and Japan, especially looking at military protection. That's very important.
Yeah. I have a question. My name is Jochen Möckel from Möckel Consulting in Düsseldorf. Mr. Walk, thank you very much for your interesting presentation, especially the long-term data is very interesting, which we normal people don't see every day. It's very, very interesting. Thank you very much. I have a question regarding the idea of the JEC, Europe and Canada and Japan. That's a very nice idea. The thing is, as a counterweight to America, it's, I think, only an idea, which is very nice, as I said, but I think there's so many contracts and it's so interwoven, everything. And how would you start such a counterweight to the US? That would be interesting for me. We all talk, especially since times of Trump. We probably the majority of the world wishes a counterweight to that. But yes. There is a time after Trump as well, and we must not forget what America did for us. Still, people say we need a counterweight to the United States. I personally think it's not really possible, as you mentioned, military issues. So the idea is very sexy, Japan, Europe, and Canada. But yeah, how do you have an idea how this could be started?
So I didn't mention the United States. I mentioned Donald Trump when I talked about the power politics of the US, because I think it's really something which is very closely connected to the person of Donald Trump.
Right.
And probably the policy which would be made by Biden if he wins the presidential elections. But unfortunately, when I look at the polls, I see that Trump is gaining in polls. So we have to think about a situation where Trump could win the elections in November and have another 4 years. And here my fear is, unemployment in US is really high at the moment. I think we will have probably go to 30, 40 million unemployed people in the peak. And then when the recovery comes, unemployment will decline slowly. And I think in Trump's mind, he has to do something to support jobs in the US. And his first option is probably make another trade war. And so probably the idea of Japan, European Union, Canada working together would be probably the first step would be to now prepare an answer to a new acceleration of the trade war coming from the United States. So if all the three regions find an answer to a new step in the trade war, that would be a first step. And I think then probably Trump would think twice about really accelerating or escalating the trade war again. And if we I think that would be a first step. So prepare together an answer to a new escalation of the trade war. That could be the first step. And if we could communicate this already to Donald Trump ahead, then maybe he doesn't use this option. And I think that would be already a big success. And second, a second step would be to think about the World Trade Organization. So if all three regions work together, maybe clearly I would say there is a need to reform the World Trade Organization. And if the three regions work together on a reform proposal, it would also have more weight than if only the European Union or Japan or Canada each presents its own proposal. I think this could be a second step.
Yeah, thank you. And just one more thought. Yeah. Canada is one country, Japan is one country. I'm talking about decision making. And Europe is 27 countries. So this is where I see a bit difficult, but the idea still is very nice. And one more thing, China, you said there's so many ifs. If China, if America, China, I think China is going her own way because it's a different system. They do actually play a power game and they have been doing it for a long time. And we always say, if China does, yes, they are reliable in a sense, but also they are not to be influenced by any country, I think. Just a notice.
As long as China wants to export, it has to find a way, or it has to have an idea how it wants to trade in the future. That would be the point where we can find a negotiation or a solution with China about global trade. But I'm really also not very sure about what is the intention of China about world trade, about their position in the world at the moment. They could go in the direction of pure power play. And in this case, I think they would try to create own area of influence. And probably the Road and Belt Initiative would be the basis. So the countries who are participating in this initiative, I think that would be what China would try to, where China would try to create its zone of influence. That would be the one option for China. The other option would be, we want to export to Europe, we want to export to the United States, we want to have a peaceful world, we want to work together on climate change and other global issues, then we have to cooperate and play a positive role, and that would be the second option. And I really, at the moment, I really cannot say which option China will choose going forward.
Right. Thank you very much.
This is Kazuya Yoshida from Tokyo. I fully agree with your discussion between you and Mr. Merkel. I'm quite worried about the situation of China. We must be cautious to depend on China further on in the meaning of their huge market size as well as global supply chain. China will surely try to expand their influence not only in the economic area, but also in political and ideology area, I think. If China succeeds in overcoming the pandemics of corona, they might continue their way with propaganda for not only overall control system, including surveillance society with information communication technology, but also with violation of the security treaty, I think, and also human rights and intellectual property rights of other countries. Some countries of citizens like Italy or Slovenia might have sympathy on or even praise on the way of China if their totalistic way of overcoming corona together with financial support for other countries proved to be effective at the end. How Germany and Japan should act as a liberal and democratic society is a quite important theme, I think. Especially what I want to ask you, German, is that Germany's role in variable as a rare country which directly experienced two dictatorships that emerged one after another during the 20th century. That is the tragedy of national socialism and also communism, or we can say Stalinism, isn't it? That's my question. Thank you.
Yeah, it's a very difficult question to answer. Really difficult question to answer, but I think, I can only make some general comments. So my idea is a little bit, I don't know if you know the picture of the shark on one hand and the small fish on the other hand. And if the small fish work together, then they can beat the shark. And that was a little bit the idea. And as you mentioned, Germany, Japan, Canada, and also the US have a history as liberal societies. And that's why I think it's so important, even more important now than in the past, to work together and also show power so that other countries also see their limits to their power and also try to cooperate and make positive contributions to the world and to world society. And that's why I think it's so important at the moment to show that we are working closely together, to show that other countries have, or the countries who think they are very powerful, to show them their limits. And then probably we can come to a cooperative solution in the world. Yes, very difficult question.
We all know that the Chinese market is quite huge and attractive. So yes, we tend to yield to this attractiveness of Chinese market. But yes, it is quite dangerous, and it's the level of the danger is the same as Corona, I think. So what I want to say is that we, Japan and Germany, these liberal countries, must be aware of this danger.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes. That's what I want to say. Yeah. Thank you.
Johannes Weisser from Generalkonsulat in Kobe. Thank you very much, Mr. Wolke. And I wanted to ask, because you said you were talking about the real danger of Italy committing economic suicide. So my question is, if you could elaborate a little bit more about what you think are the most likely scenarios for the, you know, future financial stability of the European Union, and also time frame. And the second part of the question is from an, you know, asset management perspective, if you have any interesting ideas to bet on this possible scenario.
Okay, so about Italy, I think the problem is Italian government debt to GDP ratio is around, before the crisis was around 135% of GDP, and after the crisis I have seen forecasts of 160 to 180% of GDP debt to GDP ratio. That would be basically on a level with Greece when they were in the sovereign debt crisis. So Italy would become like Greece. And then the question is it a problem or not? If Italy would still have their own central bank, then the central bank could print money, interest rates would remain low, the currency would depreciate, and there would be no need to worry about a sovereign debt crisis in Italy. But Italy basically borrows money in euro, and for Italy it's a like a foreign currency. So maybe you have followed Argentina. They have gone bankrupt, I think, 3 times in the last 20 years. It was always on dollar debt. So foreign currency borrowing is very dangerous for governments. And for the euro area, like every government is basically borrowing in a foreign currency. But we have the ECB. They can support governments to some extent. But the problem is they are legally constrained. So the ECB can buy Italian governments to some extent. They are already buying at the moment, but it's not enough. The interest rate every day is going up in Italy. And the higher the interest rates, the higher the interest rate burden for the government, and the higher the debt to GDP ratio, and the higher the probability of a debt crisis. So if on the European level we don't find any solution to finance Italy with money from the European Stability Mechanism or from the European Union budget or with Corona bonds, then interest rates in Italy will go up and up and up, and we will have a sovereign debt crisis, and Italy is too big to fail, so we would have a huge economic crisis in the euro area, and maybe even a breakup of the euro area, because Italy would then leave and introduce its own currency. So that's why I think my base case scenario is that on a European level, we will find a solution that Italy gets enough money so that there will be no debt crisis in the near future. And I think today we have the meeting of the heads of government of the European Union, and there are some expectations that a rescue package will be decided today. So that's my expectation, and then interest rates in Italy will decline again and everything will be fine. So that's the near-term risk for Italy. The medium-term risk is the political situation in Italy. There's a very nice page, it's called politico.com, and there you can see the polls in all European countries. And there you can really get a good feeling about political sentiment in Europe. Maybe I can send you the link later on. You can see that there has been a huge shift to extremely right-wing parties in the polls in Italy in recent weeks. And if you look at German newspaper articles or newspaper articles in the in Europe, you see that in Italy there's the feeling we are in an extremely difficult crisis. There's no help from Europe, especially no help from Germany. So the first thing what Germany did when the Corona crisis started was to make an export ban on medical goods. So Italy really needed medical goods, but they couldn't import from Germany because of a government export ban. So the feeling is Italy is left alone in the crisis, and even so, that Germany is asking for austerity maybe in the future. So the right-wing parties, they are telling you don't need to rely on Europe. Germany will ask for austerity very soon. And so the sentiment is extremely negative for Europe and for the euro in Italy at the moment. This is reflected in the polls. And so if there's no shift in sentiment, maybe in the next election, maybe in 2 years' time, if the government in Italy remains stable for the time being, and a new Italian government says Europe is only damaging Italian society and the Italian economy, we have to basically leave the euro and the European Union, then we are better off. And that is the more serious medium-term risk, I think. But the good news, relatively good news, is that we can only see this political situation in Italy. So when I look at Spain or Portugal, I see relatively stable stable governments and the mainstream is well supported. It's only an Italian issue.
We will leave this virtual meeting room a little bit open for the next half an hour. So if you would like to continue discussing this matter, or if you want to pose another question or a comment, you just stay on the phone, so to say. Or if you hang up, you will see a chat room opening where you can also communicate in writing. We wish you a very successful day. Stay healthy, and please tune in later at some other occasion. Thank you very much.